cry out for prayer. We are in a time where God is calling his people to prayer because the things we're dealing with are spiritual and not physical. And the only way to fight spiritual war is with spiritual weapons. So this morning we come with a war cry, calling all of those that know the power of prayer together so that we can unite in the spirit and tear down the kingdom of heaven. 2 Chronicles 7:14 says that if my people called by my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal their land. So this morning we come crying out. This is a war cry. We are calling all soldiers to the battlefield.
You are mine. I'm glad that you're here with me for another broadcast. This is the day that the Lord has made. Come on, let's rejoice. Wherever you are, put those hands together. Let's rejoice. In that comment section, you ought to just write praise, praise, praise. Let's just give God praise for all the Lord has done for you. Psalm said, brought me out of darkness into the marvelous light. Look where he brought me from. God has really brought you from a long way. You ought to celebrate today that you are alive. Come on, celebrate right now. Celebrate. In that comment section, type the word celebrate. You ought to celebrate life. God is good, isn't he? The Lord has been good to us. Kept a shelter over our heads, clothing on your body, food on your table. But more than that, the Lord gave us Jesus as eternal salvation so we can live even after we die over here. We live in the presence of the Lord. Oh, that's something to shout about right now. That when you miss me from singing down here, and you can't find me nowhere, come on, look to bright glory. I'll be waiting up there. So God is good. God is gracious. God is miraculous. God is magnificent. God is wonderful. What a wonderful God we serve. Thank you, Jesus, for another day. Come on, we all just put our hands together and tell the Lord, thank you, Jesus, for another day. Let's go to God in prayer. Oh Lord, how excellent is your name. How marvelous are your works. Thank you for one more day. Thank you for one more time. Thank you for just watching over and taking care of us. Now, use me to preach your word so that your glory will be magnified, so that your glory will shine in rooms, so that your glory will shine even through this virtual presence. And I and we will give you all of the praise, all of the glory and all the honor. It is in your name that I thank you. Amen. Come on, put those hands together and let's give God a hand to praise right where you are now. Those of you listening to us for the first time, we're glad to have you with us. So in that comment section, either on Facebook or YouTube, whichever one you are, go into the comment section and just type, if you're new, just type the word new. If you've been with us for a while and we've adopted you into the family, even if you didn't formally get into the family, we adopted you in. If you've been here more than one time, then I don't consider you new. Go ahead. Those who've been with us, you know what to do. In those comment sections, type welcome. So glad to have you with us on another day. It's another day's journey. I'm glad about it. I got my health and strength, and I'm glad about it. He's keeping us alive, and we're glad about it. All right, let's go to the Word of God. The book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3. I'm reading from the King James, the New King James Version of the Bible. Here's what it says. To everything, there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. Let me read that again. To everything, there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. Subject this morning, when is it my time? When is it my time. COVID-19 has made a difference in how we conduct our lives, how businesses operate. I thank God for our medical research people who have worked hard for a COVID vaccine. The other morning, I was listening to one of our local news affiliates. A very disturbing number of cases of folk from other states receiving the Florida vaccines kind of caught my attention. I'm not a master statistician or a mathematician, but I can add and subtract. 39,000 doses of the COVID vaccine went to people from other parts of the country. Well, I told you, I'm not a statistician, I'm not a mathematician, but if we don't have 39,000 doses now in Florida for the people in Florida, I think that means we're 39,000 doses in the red. I say that because some of the folk I know, some of the folk who are probably listening today, when the vaccine was sent to this county, they went to the municipal stadium, and some of them stayed all night long to be able to ask the question the next day, when is it my time? You ought to type that in that comment section. Stay busy in that comment section. When is it my time? I cannot begin to fathom staying out there in the stadium parking lot all night long and waiting till the next day, and then you may have had an appointment on the schedule and given a number, but you didn't know when your time was going to come up on the schedule. The question could be asked, when is it my time? When is it my time as a citizen of these United States of America not to be treated like a second or third class citizen of the United States of America? Thank God we've got a new president, got a new vice president who is a woman, who is a woman of color. That's great. But we're not done yet. We can't just stop here, celebrate, and then get to work. But the question comes up from Ecclesiastes and the writer, when the writer says, to everything there is a season, which lets us know that our lives are part of a season. Some things you needed when you were young, you don't need that anymore. So seasons change. Even farmers, you can't plant some crops all year long because the season isn't right for it. Everything, there's a time to plant and there's a time to harvest. There is a season. But the last part of the verse says, a time for every purpose under the heaven, which means that God, for every born again believer, the Lord has put purpose in your spirit. You ought to hear me now. You ought to put in that comment section, God has a purpose for me. God has put purpose in your spirit. He built you that way. You came from your manufacturer that way. If you are a born again believer with purpose in your spirit, and because you got purpose, purpose in your spirit. It also means that you got to have a vision for the purpose. Come on, walk with me today. Walk deep, walk deep. Put in that comment section, walk deep. Come on, walk with me today. It's crucial for you to know the vision that's inside of you. God put you here with a purpose, not just to populate the earth. And purpose has vision. God has put a vision inside of you, my listener. And the question can be asked, when is it my time? Remember, we're on the clock. There's a time to be born. When a person's born, there's a birth certificate. It has a time and the day and the year of when a person was born. And when a person dies, there's a death certificate saying when they die. And so we're really working between the dash. The dash to say you were born this time, there's a dash, and then we die this time. We're working between the dash. And the question is, when is it my time? And with purpose comes vision, and there's a dream in your spirit. Don't you give up in 2021. Don't you give up on your dream. God has put dream in your spirit, and God will bring it to fruition at the time that it's right. So in your season, God determines what's going to happen. And you know what? This all fits into a pattern because really, God uses the time when you were born. God really chose the time that you were born for a reason. You just didn't pop up on earth just to populate this place. And you weren't brought in by any other means. God chose the time. Ecclesiastes 3:2 says, it's a time to be born. And you were born at the right time to accomplish your vision during your generation. You ought to type in that comment section, I was born at the right time. But as I peruse this pericope and my exegetical analysis of the entire context, there were three things that really got my attention as I moved through the periphery of it. I saw three things. One thing that I saw was called a responsible urge. A responsible urge. So I move to Ecclesiastes 3:10. You see, you can't just read one verse and get everything. You have to look at the context so you don't take that verse out of, help me somebody, context. Point one, if you're taking notes, responsible urge. Responsible urge. Ecclesiastes 3:10 reads, I have seen the burden God has laid on men. I was very awestruck with the writer and the use of the word burden. Burden usually means heavy responsibility. As a matter of fact, the Hebrew wordage does say, and it's translated as heavy responsibility. But there are also some other parts of the definition that says occupation or task. Occupation or task. So this can be described as a responsible urge. You've got an urge. Some of you have had that urge in your spirit. I think at times God has to give us a shove in the right direction. When we're taking too long, if you got a good fellowship and relationship with God, God knows your heart, God knows your spirit, sometimes God gives you a little shove. That's the responsible urge, just to move you in the right direction. Every human being, I told you, all of you are born with a purpose. And that purpose seems to weigh on you. Some dreams keep coming back to you. You've got vision in your spirit. You've been impregnated with purpose and vision. God has put that in your spirit. And when will you give birth to it? The Lord has put it in. And so the question is, when is it my time? When will you go through and do what the Lord needs you to do so you can birth out of you something that will bless you and bless the world? Some of you listening to me today might hold the keys to solving some of the problems in the world. When is it my time? You ought to put that in the comment section. When is it my time? And whether does not matter whether you are 6, 26, 36, 46, 56, 66, 76, 86, or 96. There's a responsible urge. There's a burden of responsibility. You got that burden of responsibility on you to carry out what you were designated to do. God put you here with a purpose. But the question that you need to be discussing with God is, when is it my time? God, when are you going to move with me? Not a question in complaint, but a question saying to God, I'm ready. Whenever my time occurs, when is it my time? I was born to do something that I must fulfill. You've got to keep that in your spirit to say to yourself all the time, when you're getting down or your vision doesn't seem clear, you ought to say to yourself, I was born to do something that I must fulfill. Even if you don't know what it is, you ought to still say to the Lord, I'm encouraged because I know I was born to do something that I must fulfill. It has been said that there are three classifications of people in the world. Let me just go through that with you. There are those who never seem to be aware that things are happening around them. There are those who have no clue that other things are going on around them. That's the first group. The second group, there are those who are always asking, man, what just happened? What just happened? They're missing it. But there's the third crew, and I'm claiming membership in this third crew. There are those who make things happen. I want to be a part of that third crew with the Lord to make things happen. When is it my time? My time is when the Lord moves me in that direction. Your time can be every day. God moves us in seasons, but you don't know how long the season is. At the same time, you can have season today, season tomorrow, season the next day. And as God develops seasons, your time changes. In other words, your effective date for doing what God has put you here to do may change, because as God moves seasons around in your life for your full development, your perspective may be different, but your purpose remains the same. Did you hear me? Your perspective may be different, but your purpose has to remain the same. If you pursue it, God will do it. And if you don't pursue it, then it doesn't get done. Are you still listening to me right now? And so the cost, there is a cost for not following your heart. The cost of not following your heart is spending your life wishing that you had. The cost of not following your life is wishing that you had. Let me encourage you not to waste your time on jealousy. Stop worrying about the haters. Don't waste your time on jealousy. Jealousy, y'all need to hear this, is a gift robber. Y'all put that in the comment section. Jealousy is a gift robber. When your time comes and you're moving into your vision, stop and do not waste your time on jealousy, because jealousy is a gift robber. Jealousy is an energy drainer. Why? It always takes away the passion and the drive from your life. When you're focused on jealousy, you're not focused on the Lord. Because what happens is it comes as a distraction. Just because somebody else did something that you thought you might have done first, it doesn't matter. There's a season for you. You ought to say that with me. God has a season just for me. Come on, put that in the comment section. God has a season just for me. There's something within you called by eternity. You ought to feel the urge that God has put something in your spirit. Some dream, some ambition, some aspiration. God is talking to you right now. Can you hear God in your spirit? And God has placed this responsible urge, I call this first born, on your heart because of his purpose for you. You were born at the right time for your greatness. But the second thing that I saw in my studies of this message is this. It's on God's time, not mine. I'm kind of answering the subject, when is it my time? It's on God's time, not mine. Ecclesiastes, as I read through chapter 3, I noticed in verse 11, I parked there because it reads, he has made everything beautiful in its time. That's powerful. He has made everything beautiful in its time. There's something within you that's being called by eternity. Eternity is speaking to your purpose. Eternity, or yes it is speaking to your vision. That is, unless you turn a deaf ear to it. Then every day you wake up hearing a call that comes from outside of this world. The Lord is working on you right now. We live in time and space, but time and space, hallelujah, are connected to eternity. And God has put something into your heart that calls the invisible to become visible. God has put something into your heart that brings the unseen into vision. Those who spend their time looking for faults in others usually make no time to correct their own lives. But there is something that bridges us, that tenders our hearts, that gets us ready when our time comes. When is it my time? Prayer is the bridge between panic and peace. Y'all ought to write that down. That's deep there. Let me say that again. Prayer is the bridge between panic and peace. The vision that God has put in your heart is a piece of eternity that he gave you to deliver you in time and space on earth as we work between the dash. What God put into your heart is also what's in God's heart. You see, God wouldn't put nothing in you that God didn't have in himself. Follow me. He puts it in you for a purpose. But the first thing I noticed in this text was the responsible urge. The second thing, it's on God's time, not mine. But there is a third thing in this text that I need to bring out. I need to shovel it out. Deep calling deep. Deep calling deep. When is it my time? That's really a deep question. Let me move over to a reference I saw in Psalm 42 in verse 7. Psalm 42 in verse 7 says, deep calls unto deep at the noise, oh yeah, of your waterfalls. All your waves and billows have gone over me. The Lord is trying to get your attention. God is trying to tell you something. And the Lord is working on your spirit right now to get your attention. When the Bible talks about deep calling deep, the noise of your waterfalls, all your waves and billows have gone over me. When you're dealing with vision, sometimes other folk may not understand it, but that doesn't mean you don't have vision. Sometimes you may not understand it totally because it's not your time. When is it my time? When God gets it all set up at the right time. If you do not build your dreams, if you do not build your dreams, then someone will employ you to build their dreams. Let me say that again. If you do not build your dreams, then somebody will employ you to build their dreams. Why? Don't allow small minds to convince you that your dreams are not worth anything or your dreams are too big and you'll never make it. Don't let anybody convince you that. I think about the great Louis Armstrong, who was up for audition one time to get in a particular school. And he went there when they heard him play and when they heard him sing, all of them wrote him off. And say, you know what? He's all over the place. It doesn't fit the musical repertoire of what we need. And Louis Armstrong went on to be one of the great musicians as well as a singer of the known world. In the archives of history, there his name is imprinted in the chronicles of history, but somebody thought he didn't do it the right way. Conventional only fits in the purpose and scheme of somebody else. When God is moving from deep to deep, God sets a new code of ethics. God sets a new list of direction. God puts in God's set of standards. And God has something awesome for you to do. It's your time. Why are you sitting back waiting on somebody else? God has given you a place in eternity. God has given you a place on earth. God has given you life. When will you use it to bring forth? When will you use it to give birth to that what God has put inside of you? It's a piece of it's a piece of eternity. It might make you uncomfortable or dissatisfied with your present life because you're not there yet. And sometimes, let me say this clearly, you get dissatisfied with your present life because it's not what you envision. It's not what God has set forth for you. Well, why don't you do something about it? There's some people who wish and said, oh, if I was born at another time in history, my life would be better. Even though a physician may have predicted the time of your birth, only God knew the exact date and when you'd be born. Yet, if you had been born 1,000 years ago, or even 100 years ago, you probably would be miserable because you'd be living in the wrong time. And a whole lot of folks are living in the wrong time. Not that you were born at the wrong time, but you're not living up to the purpose and the vision God has put in you. You have to live within the time frame between the dash that God has given you right now. God knew before you were conceived in your mother's womb who your parents would be. With God, there are no accidents or prediction or approximates. God is always thorough, correct, perfect, and accurate. And what he has done, doing, and will do for your life remains to be seen. I know God is not through with you yet, but the writer of Ecclesiastes in verse 1 says, there's a purpose, and there's a time and a season under the heaven. There's a season to everything. There's a season, a time for every purpose under heaven. And here is a big picture. It doesn't really matter where you are or what you have or don't have, as long as you can see what you could have. God is waiting to birth out of you. God is waiting on you to start a new season in your life. Don't be listening to your haters. Change upsets people who are content to be stagnant, but that shouldn't stop you. You should be known for your vision and not your slackness in life. Don't get discouraged when people say, oh, here she comes up with another bright idea. Might I remind you that the telephone that you're using today started as an idea with Alexander Graham Bell? He believed that electrical impulses could be transmitted through wire. All the folk thought Bell was crazy, but oh, look at us now with our cell phones. Thomas Edison would be locked up in a room 8 to 9 days at a time working on experiments, and folk thought he had lost his mind until he gave to the world the electric light. And now we all benefit from that light. Moses, the great civil rights leader for the Israelites in the Old Testament, had a speech impediment. Couldn't talk clearly. Sometimes he stammered and stuttered. His parents, he was born to a Hebrew parent, but raised in the king of Egypt's palace as a prince. He was born at the right time. This was the time that God needed a leader like Moses for the children of Israel. He led them out of bondage into freedom. Joshua, the mighty warrior, was born at the right time. Right as Moses died, God put him in place, installed him as a leader of Israel. And Joshua, being the warrior, led that charge around Jericho. Some of you may know, may have read, may have heard about the Jericho experience. When they marched around that wall 7 times, and the 7th day, when they shouted, With the sound of the trumpet, the wall came tumbling down. And so God, my brothers and my sisters, used men like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Dr. King, born at a time like Moses, when mamas had to hide their boys from the fear of Pharaoh. Pharaoh in America then was an open racist atmosphere that existed in this country, in the South especially. But Dr. King didn't let it stop him. Kept on pushing. 15 years old. House. He kept on pressing. Earned his PhD. Kept on pressing. Led people and moved in a nonviolent way for freedom. When is it my time? The question is, when is it your time? When are you going to come up to the plate? When are you going to take a pitch? When are you going to start using what God has put inside of you? When are you going to stop complaining about others and step it up for yourself? Let me close by saying Jesus was born at the right time. He was not born to rich parents. His daddy did not own a construction company. He was just a carpenter. And Jesus, hallelujah, learned the trade from Joseph. And Jesus became a carpenter. I told you he was not born to his parents, but there was a right time for Jesus to be born. Thank God that Jesus lived his life guided by the power of God. Some said it was not long enough. But Jesus stepped out at the right time. When is it your time? When are you going to step up to the plate? When are you going to step out and step up for the Lord? When are you going to take a stand for the Lord? When are you going to let the Lord use you? When are you going to let all of that vision, all of that purpose that God has impregnated in your spirit, when are you going to let God use you? When are you going to say, God, here I am, use me? When are you going to let God give birth to that which is inside of you? When are you going to let God use you the way God wants to use you? Oh, what time is it for you in your life? When is it your time? I want to tell you right now, hello, Jesus. Oh, right now is your time. Stand up for the Lord and say, Lord, use me in your service. I'm willing to run on all the way. Somebody ought to say that with me. Lord, I'm willing. Oh, Lord, I'm willing to run on all the way. Oh, 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 man. Oh, all the way. All the way. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. All of the way. Pastor Good, I am concerned about those of you who are saved and for some reason your life got turned around. It's your time to come back to the Lord. I've said oftentimes the prodigal son came back to God. You need to come back to the Lord while you have a chance. And I pray that you will do that. Also, for those of you who are not saved, would you just pray this prayer after me? Jesus,
Come into my life. Save me. Cleanse me. Forgive my sin. Give me the opportunity of eternity for my life to be changed. Jesus, I receive you as a Savior, and I need you right now to change my life. Save me right now. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, brother and sisters, you are saved. We ought to thank God for all of those who came back to the Lord, and all of those who accepted the Lord Jesus as their Savior. That's it for today. Remember, something good is going to happen to you today because Jesus of Nazareth is coming your way. Grace, peace, and mercy be with you all, henceforth, now, and forevermore. Amen.